27,000 सर।
या मार्क्ड So, good morning all once again, and let us start today's lecture. And before that, let's have a quick recap. So, since your IAs are nearing, so I'm taking this lab a little slow so that the portion which is there for IA will be covered in depth. And also, before IA, we'll have another session, a revision kind of session before IA. Is the screen visible? I hope the screen should be visible. Please, anyone acknowledge?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, let's have a quick recap of what we did in the previous class. So, we discussed about the entropy and information gain. We saw how to compute information gain once we got the entropy for a particular value. To make it full screen. Once we got the entropy, we calculated the information gain, right? Using the entropy value, how to compute the information gain we saw, and information gain for all the attributes, for wind, for humidity, and so on, with the other attributes like outlook, temperature, and so on. Right. So after computing all the information gained for all the attributes, we saw which is the most be or the best classifier amongst all the attribute, which is the best candidate for our root node. Right. So the more the value of information gain, the node or the attribute, that particular attribute is selected as our root node. Right. And subsequently, after that, once we select the root node, we form the branches depending on the attribute value. So when we saw that attribute outlook has the most or the highest information gain, we selected the outlook as our root node, and the appropriate value for outlook were sunny, overcast, and rain. So with or considering these values for the attribute outlook, we computed which all training examples fall under that category, and amongst them, how many are positive and how many are negative. So, depending on that, we again computed the next node, which is the intermediate node for our main tree, and so on. This process gets repeated, right? The process, operates in a circular fashion or a repeated fashion. So, once we have this was one of the exceptional case where you can see that. We don't have any negative training examples here. All four are positive training examples. So since they all four are positive, so it is quite evident that the result or the outcome is positive, and we can opt to play the tennis on these particular conditions, right? So but the next question which arises, that which attribute should be tested for this mode. So, like we tested for the root node, the best classifier or the best attribute which gives us maximum information gain was selected for the root node. Similarly, the subsequent attributes will be selected depending on the highest information gain. So, for the outlook sunny, the other three attributes, other three means except the outlook, that is temperature, humidity, and wind, these three are tested. And out of whichever the maximum information gain, that particular attribute will be selected here, right? So as you can see, humidity is highest here. So clearly, humidity attribute goes here, right? And so on. The subsequent branches are then followed, and then again we go on to build the other branch of our main tree, right? So this, what you see here, it's this is a under construction tree, or you can say it's a partial tree, intermediate tree. But once we compute all the other branches, all the subsequent branches, then we have something like this. This is our final decision tree, right, for the problem playing tennis. Now, as you can see here, the humidity is selected here, and the value for humidity are formed as a branches, and then we end up having a discrete value, right? A finite discrete value as our leaf node. So in our case, in this case, the discrete value is nothing but the whether we should play the tennis or we shouldn't play the tennis, yes or no. It's a Boolean value, right? And for the other value, that is the rain aspect, again you can see here. So next best attribute was the wind attribute, and which was selected as the node here, and the tree was again formed. So as you can see, the attribute temperature is missing here, right? So we don't have temperature here because the amount of information gain that temperature gives us was not sufficient to come up to a decision. So it was irrelevant, or the attribute temperature was irrelevant to us in order to construct our decision tree. So that is the reason it is not included in this final decision tree, right? After having developed our decision tree, we saw the hypothesis space search for that particular decision tree learning, right? So what is hypothesis? You all, by now, you must be already familiar with what is hypothesis. But hypothesis space, the hypothesis space search by this particular decision tree or the ID3 algorithm is actually the set of all possible decision tree, right? So as you can see, this is a simple tree. So it is nothing but a set of all possible decision trees. Just hold on, I think there are some few people who are still joining. Okay. So the hypothesis space search is nothing but the set of all possible decision tree that we have, right? And what it does, it actually performs the simple to complex search. How? The method that it uses is hill climbing method. Now, what is this hill climbing method? It is actually the search which is performed on the basis of the information gain that we have measured, right? So higher the information gain, higher the tree climbs. And then the ID3 algorithm, the ID3's hypothesis space for all the decision tree is complete space, right? On this term here, complete, right? It's a complete space of finite discrete value function. So I hope whatever we have discussed in the previous lecture is clear. So this was the complete flow of the tree. You can see that how did we end up having this hypothesis space search in our case, that is ID3 algorithm. By first selecting the root node, then depending on the attribute, the best possible attribute is selected, and then that's how the tree is traversed. We also saw other few important aspects that ID3, when it is in the purest form, when the ID3 is in its best form, it performs no backtracking, right? The tree doesn't traverse back. This is only when the ID3 is in its purest form. And also it uses all the training examples, right? There are advantages of using all the training examples here in this case. Like it uses all the training examples at each step in the search to make these statistically based decisions. The reason, if you can recall, like the reason why ID3 is suggested is ID3 can operate for even the noisy data as well as, you know, erroneous data, right? So in order to approximate those errors or fill that gap or the absence of data, it has to consider statistically all the training examples, right? Only then it can approximate the data. So it uses all the training examples at each step in the search to make the statistically best decision. So that is actually the advantage of using it, that the statistical property that it results, or the resulting search that we have, the resulting hypothesis search that we have, is much less sensitive to errors, right? And as we have already said, that ID3 can easily be extended for handling the noisy training data, right? Noisy training data. So in today's lecture, we'll be focusing upon the inductive bias in the decision tree. We have already learned about what is an inductive bias, I think, in our module one, last topic in our module one. We saw an example, if you can recall, that we saw how inductive bias can play a role in a candidate elimination environment, right? So candidate, we had a diagram wherein we saw a basic or the typical method of candidate elimination algorithm, what is the accuracy that it produces, and when the same algorithm, the candidate elimination algorithm, when given inductive bias to it as another input, then how the accuracy is improved, right? So if you can recall the diagram that we have made, so and the definition that we have learned about the inductive bias, that it is actually the set of assumptions, right? Inductive bias is the inductive bias. If you can recall, we learned another term. It was inductive reference, right? Inference, inductive inference. So inductive bias work on inductive inferences. So what is inductive bias? It is actually the set of all assumptions that we make. So set of assumptions that, when together with the training data, right? Together with the training data, deductively justify the classification, right? It deductively justify the classification assigned by a learner. Learner is nothing but our training algorithm, right? The model, training model or training algorithm that we are making use of to help the machine learn about the training data. So it is, inductive bias is nothing but the assumptions that we make for learning, right, which help us to deductively justify the classification that we make assigned by the learner to future instances. Now, what are these future instances? Future instances is the unseen data, or the data that we have not encountered, right? The data that we have not put into training yet, the new data or the upcoming data, right? So future instances is nothing but the unseen instances or unseen data. Now, let's say when we have a collection of training examples, we are given with a collection of training examples, and there are typically many decision trees, right? By far, you must have already, made an observation that there can be many decision tree possible for particular data, right? So there are typically many decision trees which are consistent with these training examples. So whatever the collection of training examples that we have, for a single set of training examples, or the complete collection of those training examples, we can have many different trees which are consistent with these examples. Now, what is the meaning of this consistent? Being consistent here is the decision tree is complying with those examples, or they fit into those training examples. They are suitable. The decision tree is suitable for those particular training examples. When they belong to those training examples, or they fit into those training examples, we can say that particular decision tree is consistent with the training examples. So when we have these collection of training examples, and there are typically many decision trees which are consistent with these training examples, then describing the inductive bias of ID3 in our case, for the ID3 algorithm, a description of this inductive bias of the ID3 consists of describing the basis, right? It is describing the basis or the fundamentals by which it chooses one of the consistent hypotheses, one of these, all these consistent hypotheses, right? So that is an important role of inductive bias that it plays when we talk about hypothesis search. Right. So when we describe that particular inductive bias for any algorithm, in current case it is ID3 algorithm, but for that matter, describing the inductive bias for any algorithm, it consists of describing the basis, right? Describing the fundamentals, describing the basis by which it chooses, or the algorithm chooses, one of these consistent hypotheses. When we have the set of all the hypotheses which are consistent, which is the best suitable hypothesis that can be chosen depending on the description of our inductive bias. So I hope you got a better clarification of how inductive bias plays a role. So now when we talk about this inductive bias playing role in the ID3, The next major question that arises is which of these trees does ID3 choose, right? For example, we have many, like I discussed in the previous slide, there are many decision trees which can be consistent with the tree, with our training example, right? Let me show you here, right? So there can be typically many decision trees which are consistent with these training examples. Now how or which tree the ID3 will choose is the question, right? Which of these decision trees does the ID3 choose? So it chooses the ID3 algorithm. It basically chooses the first acceptable tree, right? It chooses the first acceptable tree. Now here is the twist. It's not just always the first acceptable tree, but it is the first acceptable tree that the ID3 algorithm encounters in its simple to complex search, right? It is simplex to complex search in a hill climbing fashion. So by now you must be already clear with what is a simple to complex search and the hill climbing approach that we use in the search, right? So the ID3 algorithm chooses the first acceptable tree which it encounters in its simple to complex hill search, hill climbing search, through the space of the possible trees. So whatever the possible trees that we have, amongst those possible trees, it selects the first acceptable tree, right? It does not select the first tree, it is the first acceptable. Please underline this important keyword, that is acceptable. First acceptable tree, which is the simple to complex hill climbing search, right? Now, how or what is the strategy for the ID3 algorithm to choose this acceptable tree or a simplex to complex hill climbing in the hill climbing search? Is the strategy that it uses to search is it selects a favor of shorter trees, like it selects in the favor of shorter trees compared to the longer ones. So if it encounters, by it I mean the ID3 algorithm, when it encounters, let's say, many decision trees, few might be shorter trees, few might be longer trees. By shorter I mean which has less number of branches and less nodes. And the longer trees are, of course, the trees which has longer branches and more levels of tree, levels in the tree. So it selects in the favor of shorter trees. Another strategy that it uses, that it selects the trees that place the attributes with the highest information gain. Right now, anyhow, it is going to select the highest information gain, but it selects the trees that place the attribute with the highest information gain that is closest to the root. That is another important aspect, that it selects the attribute with the highest information gain. Of course, it is going to select the attribute which has the highest information gain, like we discussed earlier, but it selects the attribute which has this highest information gain, which is the closest to the root, right? Please note that it select the attribute which is closest to the root. The basic reason, predominant reason why it selects the closest to the root is, again, to cut down the tree or make the tree more shorter, right? So when it has an attribute which has the highest information gain, as well as it is the closest to the root, then definitely we are reducing the number of nodes into the tree, thereby reducing the total size of the tree. Right, so that is the strategy that the ID3 algorithm follows in order to search the best possible decision tree. Right, so I hope this answers this question, that which of these decision tree does the ID3 choose. Now, just to put this whole thing in a nutshell, the approximate inductive bias, this is just the approximate, okay? We already saw what is an inductive bias, but just to put it into a term, the approximate inductive bias of ID3, we can say that it is the shorter trees are preferred over larger trees. So this is just the approximate, a rough inductive bias of the ID3. This is the inductive bias in the ID3, that it selects the shorter trees over the larger trees. It prefers selecting the shorter tree over larger trees. Now, so far, this is the inductive bias for the IDP. Now, let us move ahead and understand it much more in a better way. And let's see how inductive bias, how this approximation of this inductive bias can be made a little better. Right? So, to understand that aspect, let us have an example. Let's say an example of a breadth first search algorithm. You must have already learned about the breadth first search algorithm in your data structures, right? So let us understand this breadth first search algorithm in terms of decision tree, in terms of ID3 algorithm, right? So let's name it BFS ID3, okay? So we have this breadth first search algorithm, which is on the grounds of ID3 algorithm. So this, our new algorithm, that is BFS ID3, what it does, it finds the shortest decision tree. Like in the breadth first search algorithm, it finds the shortest path, right? So our BFS ID3, what it will find is, it will find our shortest decision tree and exhibits precisely the bias. Now, what is this bias? As we have already seen in the previous slide, the bias is shorter trees are preferred over larger trees. This is our inductive bias. So what BFS ID3 does is, it finds the shortest decision tree and exhibits precisely the bias. What is the bias? Shorter trees are preferred over longer trees. And then, since we are also using this BFS on the grounds of ID3, what ID3 will do is, it can be viewed as an efficient approximation to BFS ID3. Now, what is this effective or efficient approximation? It is the actual use of the greedy heuristic search, right? So ID3 can be viewed as an efficient approximation of to BFS, that is breadth first search ID3 algorithm, using a greedy heuristic search. So you all know what is a greedy search and what is a heuristic search algorithm, right? So ID3 makes use of that, the greedy heuristic search, in order to make an attempt to find the shortest tree amongst the all the possible trees that we have, right? Now it finds this shortest tree without conducting the entire breadth first. Okay, so I hope you can recall the diagram that we have seen, that I would like you to keep this particular diagram in mind, that how did we traverse when we were searching for a hypothesis space in ID3, using ID3 algorithm. So as you can see, that it doesn't traverse all the branches. It selects few important attributes and it traverses the branches of those important attributes or important nodes, right? So when we talk about BFS ID3, it attempts to find the shortest tree without conducting the entire breadth first. Right, without conducting the entire breadth first search through the hypothesis space. Now, hypothesis space search is the diagram which I just made you visible on the screen. Right. So, I hope the example is clear. How this breadth first search algorithm, which you already know, can be collaborated with this ID3 algorithm and can be used to find the shortest decision tree by exhibiting precisely the bias, our inductive bias, which says that shorter trees are preferred over longer trees. And what is the role of ID3 here is, ID3 helps us view the efficient approximation to BFS ID3 using the greedy search, right? Greedy heuristic search. And greedy heuristic search does it? It attempts to find the shortest tree without actually conducting the entire breadth first search, by making use of the hypothesis space. So moving ahead with the considering this example in our mind, keeping this example in our mind, so we can say that since this ID3 uses the information gain heuristic, right? It makes use of the information gain heuristic as well as hill climbing strategy. We can say that it exhibits a more complex bias. Right, by more complex I mean more complex compared to our previous bias, that is this bias, our approximate bias. So this was just our approximate bias, a rough bias, inductive bias. But considering this particular example of BFS ID3 and the ID3 algorithm, it makes use of hill climbing search, right? So considering these factors in mind, and also the information gain heuristic in mind, we can form a better approximation to our inductive bias. We can bring down our inductive bias much more closer, right? So having learned this, let us reframe our inductive bias for our ID3 algorithm, and it can be reframed like this, that a closer approximation to the inductive bias can be formed, like how, along with the previous inductive bias, that was shorter trees are preferred over longer trees, it remains true, it still remains true. But along with this, let me highlight it out, but along with this, the trees that place higher information gain attribute close to the road are preferred over those that do not, right? I hope you got the difference here. Now, our this approximation, this is much more closer approximation, or this is much more precise inductive bias that we have reframed now. So compared to compared to the previous inductive bias, that is our approximate inductive bias, this particular inductive bias, we can say that our new inductive bias, which is a much more closer approximation to the inductive bias, can be better defined. This is a better definition, you can say, right? So to conclude, we can say that the inductive bias for our ID3 algorithm, the important role of our inductive bias in the ID3 is the shorter trees are preferred over longer trees, number one. Along with this, the trees that place higher information gain, or the attributes which has higher information gain value, those attributes are selected which are close to the root node. This is again very important, which are close to the root node when compared to the other attributes which are not so close to the root node, right? So I hope the picture is clear, crystal clear by now, that what is inductive bias or how does it play a role in the ID3 algorithm. So that tells everything about the ID3 algorithm, its representation, the decision tree, the entropy, the information gain, right? The hypothesis space search, and as well as the important factor, the inductive bias of our ID3, right? So I would like you two guys to make note of this important aspect, whatever we discuss here. And whenever we, after every lecture, I would say, whenever you have found any doubt or anything, you can revert back to me anytime, or you can, since the videos are made available on YouTube, you can pause wherever you want, you can go through the slides, make a note of it, and later you can submit that as an assignment itself, right? So I hope the things are clear so far. So by this much, I mean, till this, the portion, this much syllabus will be there for your first time. You can consider the today's lecture, whatever we have covered so far, will be there for our first time. Fine. So, but don't miss the upcoming lectures. We will have a revision session of these, and we will have better understanding, taking more examples of what we have learned so far. So we will touch upon all the important aspects of the module 1 as well as module 2, which will be there for our IV, right? First time. So in today's lecture, or apart from it, anything that you have, any kind of doubt, the session is open for the doubt clarification. Anybody who has any kind of doubt? Or any particular slide which is not understood, and would you like me to reiterate that particular slide? Please answer. Yeah, please answer. So when you are not asking any kind of doubt, then there can be only two possibilities that I usually say. Either you understood everything, which is very unlikely, or you have not understood anything. So any particular slide, if it is not understood, you can ask me to reiterate. There's no problem. We can revisit that slide and we will have a better understanding of that particular concept. So let me have a quick recap again what we discussed so far. In that time, if you have any kind of doubt, you can ask. Okay. Okay, so this is just to recap that what we discussed. In this module, we started off with the introduction of what is this decision tree learning algorithms, right? How are they different from our previous two algorithms, that is Findus algorithm and candidate elimination algorithm. Then we also saw the decision tree representation, how can we represent a particular decision tree, right? We considered different aspect to it. And what are the best possible problems that fall into the category of decision tree learning algorithms? Right, or what are the appropriate problems for decision tree, because not all problems can follow the decision tree learning algorithm. There are few set of problems depending upon their design, depending upon their problem, the solution, the method, that we have to define whether that particular problem is suitable to make use of decision tree learning algorithm. So we saw that depending upon various characteristics, which can be segregated to say that a particular problem is an appropriate problem for decision tree learning algorithm. Then we also saw how a basic decision tree learning algorithm would look like, wherein we learned about various algorithms which make use of decision tree approach, decision tree learning approach like ID3 as well as C4.5. So C4.5 will be learning upon as and when we proceed in the next modules. But for time being, we took a basic example of ID3, right? So CE4.5 is actually a successor of ID3. So ID3 is much more basic version, you can say. So we went ahead to discuss the ID3 algorithm, the basic decision tree learning algorithm, how actual ID3 algorithm would look like and what are the different versions to it, possible changes that can be made in the ID3 algorithm, which are currently in use. But we saw a basic fundamental ID3 algorithm, right? A main original ID3 algorithm, you can say. Then we learned about the hypothesis based search in the decision tree learning algorithm. We saw with the same example, the ID3 algorithm, how a hypothesis based search is performed by ID3 algorithm. And in today's class, we saw about what is an inductive bias. We roughly defined what is an approximate inductive bias as well as a closer approximation of an inductive bias, talking about only ID3 algorithm. So inductive bias regarding candidate elimination algorithm and Findus algorithm, we have already seen in our module 1, right? So in this module, we saw about the inductive bias, how it plays a role in ID3 algorithm. So inductive bias in decision tree learning. Another important aspect in decision, the inductive bias concept is what is restriction bias and what is preferences bias. So we will cover these things in our next lecture. What is a restriction bias and what is this preference bias? So maybe till next lecture, whatever we cover will be there for the time, because we haven't yet discussed the important aspect of our inductive bias, that is restriction bias and preferences bias. So once we discuss this, you can say that up till here, the portion will be there for first time, right? And these topics here is yet to be discussed, that is issues in decision tree learning, which we will cover at the end. Because once we have the better understanding of all these aspects, only then we can define what are the issues, right? What are the drawbacks of decision tree learning, or what are the problems wherein we cannot make use of decision tree learning, right? So that's what we saw, that approximation. We started with the introduction, what is a discrete value target function, what a function, when a function can be called as a learned function. And we replaced the if then rules, how these if then rules can be re-represented with a better version. Most popular, the inductive reference algorithm. We saw the application of ID3, right? The medical, in terms of medical cases or financial domain, wherein we can compute the credit risk of loans and so on. They were the, few examples of application for this ID3 algorithm. We saw the representation, the root node, the leaf node, the classification of these instances, how to select an attribute, test the attribute, the branch value, the possible values, right? And we saw a simple example. This was just to give you an overview or an example of how a decision tree would look like, right? But this was actually our end product, you can say. This was the end result of our problem playing tennis. But we went ahead to discuss how did we end up having this decision tree by selecting each and every node, right, from root node to branches to intermediate node and to the discrete values of our leaf nodes and so on. So we started off with the root, computing the value of attributes, and the process is computed repeatedly, right? It is the process which is then repeated for subtrees at new node. We took an example of playing tennis, wherein we had one hypothesis and we computed, or we understood how or what is this decision tree representation, right? So we saw that it is basically the disjunction of all the conjunctions of constraints, right? So these were the constraints that we have, and this whole thing was the conjunction, and this whole thing was the conjunction, and disjunctions of all these conjunctions will form our decision tree. This will represent our decision tree. Then these were the problems that we saw, that the appropriate problem for our decision tree. So basic decision tree, like I said, ID3 and C4.5. So we took our basic algorithm of ID3 and we answered the question that which attribute should be tested at the root of the tree, because selecting the root is very important, one of the important step in the ID3. In fact, one of the first step is the first step in the ID3 algorithm. So once we select that best node, that particular best node is selected as our root node. This is the main algorithm, which is actually our lab third experiment, the machine learning lab experiment number 3. So I hope you are working side by side with this. I have already told you what to do with respect to the lab experiments. And ID3 algorithm, like I said, the first step was to create a root node, and then we slowly, step by step, we categorize the positive examples, negative examples. If all examples are positive, we define the root label as positive. If all the examples are negative, we define the examples as negative, and so on. So if we have a typical example where we have set of positive, set of negative, and a few common examples, then we perform this steps, right? And ultimately what we return is, we return the root node. The next very important question that we saw, that which attribute is the best classifier, and as I've been continuously repeating, that we make use of a statistical approach wherein we compute the information gain, right? How do we compute the information gain? by computing the entropy for it. Entropy is another measure to compute. It's another statistical measure to compute the a particular it helps us categorize a particular attribute, whether it is a impure or a pure attribute from the collection of the examples. So we saw an example. We took a collection of sample space S, which has a few set of positive as well as negative example, and we saw the formula for entropy, how entropy can be computed, then using the value of entropy, how information gain can be computed. This was the diagram that we saw for the information, the entropy, right? The graph for the entropy. And once we had the entropy for that, we went ahead to compute the information gain using this formula, right? So this was our training data example, wherein we have 1 to 14 examples, and each example we saw one by one, wherein we segregated by calculating the entropy as well as the information gain. So depending on the information gain, we computed the we selected the best classifier, the best attribute which can be called as a best classifier, and we went ahead with constructing the partial tree, right? So this is when we computed all the information gain and we computed our partial learned decision tree, right? And ultimately, the process is repeated to compute the all the other intermediate modes to perform a full-fledged final decision tree. And we also saw the hypothesis space search for that particular tree, how it performs the hypothesis space search. Then what are the other important nodes to be considered? And the ultimately another important factor was this inductive bias for the ID3, or how this ID3, how this inductive bias is computed for this ID3, right? So that's all for today's lecture. I think we can wind up and we can move ahead with the important aspect of the inductive bias, the preferences bias, as well as the restriction bias in our next lecture. So that's all for today's lecture. If you have any kind of doubt, you can ask. We still have 2 minutes, 3 minutes. If there are no doubts, then we can conclude the lecture. You can leave the meeting. Thank you.